Hello and welcome to part 7 of the Connect 4 in APL programming session. And I thought this would be finished, but of course you can always make the program shorter in APL and learn about the language and also about the program. So I've changed my screen resolution settings, so it should look better now for YouTube. You may not see this four. So the first thing, let's do this. And I hope you can see this now. So, we are going to learn about the power operator and for the rest, just make it shorter, okay? So, let's start here. We calculated this height of the columns with the IOTA index search function because that was the way we did it, we had done it before here. But there's another way, in a shorter way. So let's get a board up and test a few other ways how to get this valid moves. So here's an interesting way to get a board. Out of this list, let's display it. We can get a board by using the following. Operation. This makes a matrix out of a list of rows. Okay. So if we rotate this matrix now, we get an example board. So let's try, for example, this, and we see that the column that is full has all zeros here. Okay, so this would be a way to get our array that we need to select from the indices. We just OR all the rows here. So this would look like this. And we get this selection array. Now this is a much shorter expression than what we had before. But still, it takes all the places here into account. And maybe it's not from an execution time perspective, it's not the fastest way. So considering our assumption that the stones always fall down, there's a pretty easy way actually to determine which row is full, namely just take the first row here and see where are zeros in here. That's where we can put a stone in, and if there's no zero here, it's full, okay? So this would just be like this. This is short, and it's also from a time perspective pretty fast, because it only evaluates one row. There's another way we could get this first row namely like this, but it has a drawback, as we can find out here. Why is this give an error? Well, we see this if we compare it. Again, this has a vertical dimension, so to get rid of it, we would have to do this again, and then we see that these two are basically equivalent. So we could take either of these, but I like the index notation actually, so I will stick with this way. Let's test it. And it seems to work. Okay. Next is here the observation with this 7 minus and this reversed column. Okay. So we did this because we had our board printed upside down like this for displaying reasons, okay? But if we do it internally, this number form the other way around, and just for the display invert it, we can get rid of this. So now the internally the rows start from 1, and for the display we take it upside down, okay? And this of course would also mean that we have to read here the row number 6. So this should be it already. Yes, seems to be okay. So now internally it's upside down, but it's still displayed the right way, okay? So let's see if we can compress this already into one line, and it fits now. Fits now in one line. Okay. Nice. So let's do a little experiment here. What if we set this value to this? Now we should see whenever there's a losing situation, this new value, right? And what happens is that we still see the old value. Now why is this? It's because the point function, when it is called, it is always called immediately after a new stone has been added. And this can only lead to winning situations, okay? So the next time after a winning situation, of course it's a losing situation for the other player, but at this time we should already have aborted here this search. So as soon as we find a winning situation, the search is over, and that's why we can get rid of all of this and actually also this bracket. Which makes it already a bit shorter. And it still works the same. So this was redundant. Let's see if we can fit this already into one line. No. Another thing here is the player is always one or two, and this is the way we calculated the other player, but there's a shorter way. Namely, we can just take 3 minus s, and this gives the other player number. Now it fits almost. Okay. So we still need to make this shorter. Another observation is that we can put this function directly into here. So this just calculated all the boards with new stones, and instead of calculating them first and then calling the value function, we simply put it in here. Let's try it. Yes. So this is clear that this is equivalent. And now we actually see that we have here a situation where we have the player number 2 times, and we can basically incorporate this adding of a stone directly into the value function as here, so to say, as the first thing that is done here in the value function is add the stone to the board, and of course we have still the move or the column, so to say. So we have still our board and the column here. So let's call this M for move. Board move player and a depth. Doesn't work. Board move and player. Oops. Of course, this is called B now. And it works like this. So this has made this line longer, a bit longer again. Let's cut it again. So what we can do to make this shorter again is the following. Every time such an assignment is done, we can cut this out and put it here. So the assignment is a side effect of this. And again, do the same thing here for C, but now actually we have to write it like this. And since this is read from right to left, and of course from inside brackets to outside, this is executed just in the same way as before. So this bracket is executed first, gives an assignment to B as a side effect, and of course returns B, and this is then used as the board in for the points function, which gives as a side effect this assignment to C, and then it's this comparison is made, and then this C that is needed has been assigned already. Okay, so this works. We can save a space here, by the way, by changing this around a bit, so the move is now at the end. And now it should fit nicely into one line. Yes, it does. Test it. Okay. So these are just syntax transformations that make the program shorter. And for this function, so we can do this every time we have this sequence of assignments, we can look if we can rewrite it in this way. So for this sequence here, we would want to have something of the following form. Three minus s is, and then this part. Like this, right? And we can immediately see that we don't even need this V assignment here. So this doesn't work, but let's try it. This gives a rank error, okay? So how can we make this work? Well, let's take an example. Let's take this test matrix and we would want to make these two comparisons in one. Go here to get the demo version. These two comparisons in one expression, and this gives a rank error. Why? Because here is a matrix. So what we need is either something like this with two entries, or something with one entry, so that this one entry is compared first to this and then to this. And we can make one entry here if we enclose it. Okay, so this matrix is now enclosed. Let's see if we can display this. It's enclosed and thus counts as one entry, and now it's compared to first to two and then to three, and the result looks like this. Okay, and now we want to sum along the rows again. So this is not what we want to do, but we want to do this for each element of this list of matrices, and this is exactly what we want to get. Okay, or like this. Now the one is here. This is the second row of the B matrix. So now this works if we enclose this B and sum here for each of these two. Okay, and then the assignment can go directly to these two variables. Let's rename these. Let's call this player and the other player. Other player, this, other, and this. And test it, and it works. Okay, so can we make this expression shorter? If you remember, this was the summation over the row sums. Then, in case when the other player has a zero, There, okay. Let's see if we can do this a bit shorter. So let's make a test. Row sum test case, for example, could look like this. Okay. Now we want to calculate T minus O, this player minus the points of this player minus the points of the other player, but exclude cases like this, and of course like this, but zero doesn't of course matter for a sum. So what if we take this product? So this is a product of the single elements here, and we can see that if we make this comparison, this filter, so to say, that we can filter out the parts that we don't want to have. So where both here have a value, the product is not zero, and thus it can be filtered out. So this would give the actual values that we want to sum over. The zero here doesn't matter. So now if we sum over, this should give the correct result. Let's see, it should be 1, minus 1, minus 2, minus 4 is minus 6. So this gives now the correct result, and it's much shorter. So let's put it here, see if it works. Yes. Okay. So this part is now nice and short. There's only one thing remaining. Maybe let's rename all these variables, okay? So for example, we see here we return a C, but it's a value, and here we return a column, but it's called V. So let's call all the columns C and all the values V and so on. So let's look, let's start here. So we add to a board a column and a stone. So this is okay if we rename this here as a column. Board, stone, and this and other player. So this is okay. Here we see that T is used for depth. Not to be confused with this T, so let's call it D for depth, search depth. And here. And here the move, this is called move, but this is really also a column, okay. And then we see that we have here the points are called C. So let's call these P for points first, and then let's call the move actually a column. So this should be okay now. Let's test it. Okay, seems to be still the same. And now here, this gives a column, and this gives an actual value. So these are just interchanged. A is really also a column. So here we have an array with columns, and we get out one column of this. So this is no problem in APL. Just reuse this variable and have a different type. And here we have also a column like this. Still working? Yes. So let's take care of this part now and make this way shorter. So there's many things we can do here. First of all, let's rename the board to B. Because I think earlier we had a B there, and we don't need this now anymore. So we can name this now B. Okay, working. And there's a different method here for the input. Namely the execute function. So what execute does is take a string, a character string, and execute it as an APL expression, okay, and return the actual numeric value. So this is not another character string, but this is the actual value. So we can take this as an input, simply input function like this. Now we could even input expressions here. Funny. And it's much shorter than the calculation that we had before. So now another thing here is how we get this maximum here out of the list of values. There's also a shorter expression for this. Namely using here this grade down. So this sorts an array of values from the highest to lowest and gives as result a permutation vector. So it gives as result an index of an array of indices, and if we take the first index of this result, so let's test it. And the first index we could get like this, for example, and this is the index of the first maximum, so exactly what we need. So the nice thing about this is that we have the V only once here, and it's shorter all in all. So let's use this. And of course we can again do our assignment chain here. So this would look like this in this case. Now we could take this expression and put it in here, but let's leave it this way for now. Okay. So now for the main part actually, namely how to use the power operator to get this main loop to be much shorter. Okay. So the power operator, let's test it first here on the command line. The way what it does is simply, let's write the test function. So this does nothing, okay, first of all. In order for this to do something, we have to give a write argument here. And what it does is simply print out yes, okay. So if you want to do this three times, we could do it like this. Or we could use the power operator and say do this three times. With this starting value. And actually, of course, this also has a return value. So, let's test this return value, let's say 17. So, this is actually a return value, which we can see if we write it like this. So the function is only called three times, but then it returns this value. And every time here, this function has a left argument, which is called alpha, and a right argument that is called omega. Okay, so we could also print this omega, but of course only if we actually give it a value like this. Okay, and the return value here is 22, of course. And what we can now do, let's look what alpha is. Alpha has no value here. Okay. What we can do here as a feature of the power operator is, we can write a function that a Boolean function, so a function that returns 0 or 1, that is actually used to abort this sequence. So let's see what happens here. So now this alpha here is used as aborting condition, okay. And let's see if we can use omega. Yes, omega works as well. So this is a way we could program a simple loop in APL, in these D functions, dynamic functions, with the power operator. Okay. Another thing we want to have here in a loop is, of course, a condition inside the loop. So if we want to ask here for this value inside the loop, we could do it like this. So now this omega is tested inside the loop, and if this is the case, it returns this theta, and we can ask for this abort here simply by testing for an identity to theta. So this would be another way to use the power operator. Or there's an even shorter way. Since alpha and omega are both known here in this function, we could test for alpha gleich omega, alpha equals omega, which means the function doesn't change from this to the next instance where it is called. So instead of returning an omega minus 1, if we return omega again, this would mean two times in a row it has returned the same omega, and this is the aborting condition here, and this has a nice shorthand. You can just write it like this. By the way, we don't need these brackets here anymore. And this is now called a fixed point iteration. So this is iterated until two times in a row the consecutive values returned by this function are the same, and then it stops. Okay. So if we just return omega, this just works. So this is how we can do a forever loop. Now, let's test it here. This would be our function. And here we had our aborting condition was, if we input 0, we return omega, and let's see if it works. Probably not. Okay. What we still need is the starting omega. Okay, but what was our omega in our test case was these numbers, but what is our omega here? Okay, so if we look here, we already see a nice candidate for an omega, namely our board. So what we would do is take the empty board as a starting value and actually iterate over putting stones in the board until we have reached a fixed point where the board doesn't change anymore, or we abort here by inputting here 0 and then return as a return value the new board. So our omega is now our board. So what we have to do first of all is set this here, okay. And then for the next iteration we have to give this as return value. The new board is the return value for the next iteration, and we already can see here that we can write this shorter simply because like this, because the add function returns already, is already returning the board. So let's see if this works. No. Okay. So there's another thing for the d functions. We only can have assignments or so expressions like this or expressions like this. Okay. So if we want to have an output here, luckily this is also an assignment, namely here this expression assignment to screen. And it works. Abort it. And now we should have a B. We have declared it here as local. But now, of course, all the local variables are local because they are inside the defun. And let's leave the b as a global variable. So if we abort, now we have this b as our result board. And if we pretty print it, we can see that this was the last board. So this works now, looks much nicer, and doesn't use these repeat and end and so on. And it's shorter. Okay, so we could finish here and put these in two lines, maybe these would fit in two lines. But there's another thing I want to do. Namely, while playing against the computer test matches, of course you get sometimes to a situation where there's either a win or lose almost at when the board is full, so only with one or two fields remaining, or maybe even there would be even a draw, which is also possible in Connect 4. So that nobody has won and the board is full, and then this program crashes. Okay, why does it crash? Because we have this search depth of 4 moves ahead, and of course if there are only 2 moves left, there's no way the computer can search ahead 4 moves, and the list of value of valid moves becomes empty. Okay. Now you could say, okay, here if this for each works on an empty list, this part isn't called, isn't executed. Okay. But this is not how the for each works. If for each encounters an empty list, it still is executed once, but with a placeholder instead. Okay. So this could work if APL was different there in this case, but luckily there's another way, which is actually more elegant even, namely simply adapt the search depth to the number of moves left. So we would have a number of moves left and take the minimum of these two. So if there are only two moves left, the search depth would be 2 in this case. Okay. So we need here the number of moves. Well, there's two ways we could do this. Okay. We could set the number of moves left here to 42, 6 times 7. Give it here as a second variable. And then we would have to do something like this, of course. And here return moves minus 1. Okay. But there's also another way. I don't even want to test and try this. Namely, the number of moves left on a board is of course just the number of zeros in it. Okay. Here in our case. So we would simply have to count the number of zeros in this matrix, and this is let's do a test matrix. This could be either done like this, or we could make a flat matrix first. Okay. So this comma, as you remember, flattens the matrix, and then we only need one sum. Like this. So this would give us the number of zeros, and which is also the number of the moves left for every board. So where can we put it? Doesn't matter. Let's put it here. So immediately after assigning the board, we calculate the number of moves, and actually if there are no moves left, we should abort. Okay. And this can be written much shorter, of course, again like this. So now let's test it. Okay, doesn't give a syntax error. Of course, we would have to play a full game now. Or we could just take appropriate matrix as starting matrix that is full, let's say, up to the fifth row. So let's construct such a matrix. I would say let's take something like this. But now move these parts here so that the 1, 1 and 2, 2 parts are above each other. Okay. So let's see. This doesn't work like this. This pattern. And now cut off these three rows. And the way we do this is we do a 7 take, but along the second dimension. Okay, so this gets us this. This is what I had in mind. Actually, it's important that here the first four circles. In the first row there are four circles and not the crosses, because this is player one. And you can imagine player one and two filling up these. Okay. And now let's delete the last row here. And again we can use this take operator like this, and for this we still would need to invert it, but we recall that this is actually the correct form for the internal value. For the internal board, because X in the pretty print version now this actually looks like this. So if we delete this row and then take the 6x7 form again, it's automatically filled up with 0. Okay. So now this would be our starting test board. Let's try this. Put it here. Board. Let's see what happens. Index error. That's exactly what happens. Because the depth is not appropriate here, but we already had inserted this expression, so why doesn't it work? Well, actually this is because we have here a 0. Okay. So we need to subtract 1 here. Let's see if it works now. No, still doesn't work. Another thing is that of course here actually the cross. It would be the cross's turn here to move first, and maybe that's the error. So let's see if we can do this. So we would have to determine the player that whose turn it is. Okay, with player one always starting on an empty board. And again, we could do it like this: have a starting player and then alternating here at the end, but again using our knowledge of the moves left, we can simply take the moves left modulo 2, which gives of course 0 or 1 for even or odd moves. And since our player is 1 or 2, we have to add 1 here. Okay. So for the even moves like 0 and 2 and 4, this would be player 1, and for the odd moves this would be player 2. And now, so actually for this situation, if we are as human always player 1 with a circle, actually it would be here the computer's move. So we, in this situation, we don't have the first move here. Okay, it would be the computer's move. And actually that's something nice to have. So how could we modify the code that we can choose if it's our move or if it's our turn or the computer is to move? Well, we have here these parts that look actually quite alike, with printing the board, and then something happens, human or a computer makes a move, and then the stone is added to the board. What if we could do these two steps like this and only print the board once, and also add the stone only once? Okay, for a player S, and for the part in between, so this would have to go here. And for this part in between, just have if condition determining whose turn it is. So like this, let's use the dynamic function again. S as an input, and the column actually as output. Like this. So we would have, if omega, or which is now the S, the player, if player is 1, then we want to have our human inputting his column, and else we would have our computer make a move, and this is his return value. Okay, so this already fits in a line like this, and in this case the computer is always player 2, but to be completely general here, we would have to put the S here. Okay, S is for this inner D function, the S from outside here is actually a global variable, so it can see it. We can't write omega here because this is the omega for this defun. Okay, and here the omega is S. We could write S here, but let's write omega here. So let's see if this works now. Yes. So why did the computer make a move now? Because the computer plays as cross, as player 2, and determined from the 7 moves left, it has determined that it's the computer's turn. And so this works now. And actually the problem from before has gone. This works now entirely. It has detected that when the board, so we reached a draw here, nobody won, there are no moves left, and it aborted the main loop here with this condition that the moves left are 0. Okay. Now this can be written a bit shorter, which saves this line. And let's test if the other part also works. So if we take our normal starting position, this works as usual, but if we want to play as player 2 now, this should simply work if we put a 2 here, and the computer should start, and it does. And we can play as player 2. Okay. So we've seen that the computer for this search depth 4 chose didn't choose the middle column as a starting point, because it got these point values of 5 and 6, and then it just simply chooses the leftmost here. So we could either adjust our point evaluation function, or we could see what happens if we increase the search depth to 5 and actually we see that with a search depth of 5 it chooses, it prefers the middle column again. Okay, which is a bit slow for the beginning, but as soon as columns get full it gets faster again. Okay, so this looks nice already. Let's see how many lines this takes. And we can see it fits nicely in two lines again, and it's pretty much done now. So let's recap. We have added the functionality that we can play either as player 1 or 2 now. And we have added the possibility of a draw, so the program doesn't crash anymore when the board gets near full. We have added this abort here, and yeah, we've tested it. So this is, and we've used the power operator with a fixed point board. So again, to explain this again, fixed point means we return two times the same board in consecutive calls, which means we return omega here. Okay, omega is the input, the write argument, and if we return it unchanged, this is detected by this identity and means abort this power operator iteration here. Okay, otherwise the board changes because we add a stone here. Okay, so this is finished now. I hope it was interesting and it helped you learn something about APL. Another thing is the source code is on my GitHub page. So there's two ways you could do this. You can take this, copy it, and simply put it in a text editor that can display this APL font. Okay. So what I've done here is I've chosen this APL 385 Unicode font with the exact same size that I also have in the dialog editor. So this looks exactly the same, just that it's not colored. Okay, you could take this and let's see, let's actually clear this workspace. So everything is gone now. Okay, everything has been deleted, But you can take this now, copy and paste it here, press return, and now all these variables and functions are actually have been defined here, and you can simply call main. And the computer started. So this is now all done in this workspace, and if you would edit main now, it would look like this, or edit point. So to have this in a namespace again, that's the other thing you could do. You could make a namespace like this, like we have done it in the beginning, the start of these videos. Call it something. And now you have again this namespace. Now you have it in this form again, okay? So this concludes, I hope, this concludes these videos. And maybe next I will look into adding alpha beta pruning, which is a technique to search this game tree, okay, quicker, faster, more efficiently. And maybe this could be the next part, but for now this concludes it, and as I said, I hope it was informative and interesting and not too boring, and maybe I'll see you next time. Bye.